some ways as a retreat from life and from doing damage, inflicting any more damage on people she cares about.
Mm-hmm. So. Meanwhile, Max, who is the friend from, because I kept saying, how is this going to end up playing? I mean, now we talk about the mystery and how you set up the various stages.
Yeah, and the mystery, it reflects my interest in how people are connected in ways they don't even know across great amounts of time.
Yeah, the 6 degrees of separation.
That's right.
Yeah.
And how also the consequences of decisions that are made decades earlier, how they play out in our present, in our present mm-hmm. day. I really believe this is our fundamental condition, and I tried to dramatically present that in the book.
What intrigued you about Christianity and Catholicism?
Well, as Hannah says, she felt from a very early age that it addressed weakness as a form of power, actually, and so. That's one of the things that interested me and interests the character.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it gave her something to do with her sense of her own frailty and weakness.
And yet there is Max with Carmen, his caretaker. Daniel is one of those men who he does commit. I mean, he's married twice, but he keeps himself like the man in the glass booth.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and at one point in the book, there's this idea that all the characters in the book are marriage artists, you know, not just the one who illustrates marriage artists. And so Daniel was one of the vehicles for me to explore the different ramifications of what marriage might mean.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And what does it mean?
Well, you know, a novel asks questions, it doesn't answer them, but some of the questions that the book asks are, is marriage a kind of secular contract with the state?
Mm-hmm.
Is it a contract with the partner? Is it a contract with God? Is it a way?
That's what Max says.
Right.
In doing this ketubah, you are making a contract with God and to satisfy your wife.
That's right. Yeah, that's one of the lovely.
I didn't know that until I read your book.
One of the lovely things about this ancient document is that it tells the husband that he must gratify the wife.
Yeah. And that too, it was interesting how Joseph, at one point, when the Nazis have come in and his wife is going to the hospital, and they are attacked. They're not attacked. It is so dangerous. It is so frightening as you read it. Of the two Nazi officers who are there at the corner, see them almost like pigeons. They're going to shoot. Yeah. And they come, and the fear that they will rape the wife without any qualms. And they have to talk it out. And that's when they say to Joseph, what do you do for a living? He says, I am the marriage artist.
Right. Yeah, and they mock, they think he's joking, and they kind of participate in this this mocking tone that actually is first established by Joseph's father. And so that's picking up this motif throughout the book.
Yeah.
That he's almost a con artist of marriage. And in fact, the two officers who catch them on the street corner find them in the middle of a fight with each other. So it's very complicated.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And frightening. It's a very more frightening than if they had pulled the gun.
That's right. And that's one thing I wanted to capture was what it was like to still live in a great city, not in the concentration camps, but before that. What it was like to actually still be in the cities.
And to wear the yellow star.
And to still try to figure out the things that we all try to figure out, which is how do I make a marriage work?
Yeah. And especially with the marriages you show here with Dan, they begin sexual.
Yes.
And they end up asexual.
Yeah. Yeah. There's this interesting idea that some of the marriages begin by necessity.
Yeah.
And that the lovers try to, or the people who agree to marry in this very kind of secular way for practical reasons, try to figure out then how to make it into something of a real marriage.
Yeah.
Yeah, and so that's one aspect. The other aspect is, as you say, the erotic beginnings that end less so.
The book ends with the list of names. Where did they come from?
Well, in part, I had this vision that was came partly out of this contemporary art show that is one of the central mysteries of the book. I had this vision of names whirling and dancing and possibly ascending, possibly descending, we don't know. And as they are whirling around each other and ascending, they start to the names literally start to reach out toward one another.
Yeah.
And I wanted that, again, that's picking up this theme, various themes in the book, actually.
Mm-hmm.
The actual names I are my homage to to people in Vienna who were taken from Vienna and killed.
Yeah.
And yes.
Again, Daniel's in Vienna at the cemetery, and he sees his name.
Yes, yeah, and that's an arresting moment for him, and perhaps for anybody who sees their own name engraved in stone.
What may I have missed that you wanted the reader to get from this book?
You've gotten a lot of it, I have to say. You've been very smart about it. I think the main thing, well, one of the things is that we haven't talked about is how. I think we've covered it all, to be honest.
What were you going to say?
I think one of the ways we give meaning to our lives is that all of us know that life is rather brief, and we all try to figure out ways to, whether it's, there's some kind of permanence in life. And I think one of the themes in the book that we haven't talked about is memory. And that it's in memory, at least some of the characters in my book discover, where there might be some element of the eternal.
Yeah.
That's where we carry each other. And there's, in fact, a line in the book where Daniel figures out that marriage is the eternal house.
Mm-hmm. Hope. Yeah. In a way, there's been a couple of books written by Dr. Aaron Haas. That as people who were in that era become older and they have retired, it's when the nightmares begin at night of what they have survived.
Yeah, yeah. And it's I did a lot of, I spoke with so many people and I spent a lot of time researching and living in Vienna and reading what people were reading then. And so what you're saying is very true, absolutely.
Yeah. Even when he goes back to the Vienna of today, and the guards are outside the synagogue.
That's right.
Yeah.
And what I tried to capture is how Vienna today is actually quite a haunting place, depending on your perspective. For example, when Daniel arrives at the Central Cemetery, and this is the great cemetery that holds Beethoven and many of the great musicians.
Oh, and one side is the Christian side, and it's beautiful with the green and everything. And on the other side is the old Jewish cemetery.
That's right. The Viennese were obsessed with their graves, and they put great amounts of money into savings to ensure that their graves would forever be taken care of. These were the Christians. And so when you go now today, there's this dividing line, a little dirt path. And on the Christian side is this fantastic graveyard like you've never seen.
Mm-hmm.
And on the Jewish side, there's nobody left to maintain them. And it's an absolute jungle. And it was vandalized, of course, by the Nazis.
Yeah.
And it remains lying in that state of disrepair.
But again, that's where Benjamin, almost like the ghouls, went back and uncovered graves to get the bones, to get the faces. He could then put his fabric on that when people came to that art showing was shocking.
Yeah, and that's where the artist rediscovers himself and figures out who a part of who he is by returning to that graveyard and going visiting the places where his family came from.
Were you an artist before?
I was. I was a painter in the art world in New York and partly also in Los Angeles.
Yeah. Are you still painting?
On a much smaller scale because the demands of doing something like this, this novel, kind of obviate any...
do you miss, do the hands miss the, And does the nose miss the odor of the oil?
I do. I love the smell of linseed oil. I miss that. I still look at art all the time. It means a great deal to me, and I think about it, and that's partly why I returned to it in this book, is I wanted to go back and figure out what did my experience in the contemporary art world really mean? What do I think about contemporary work? I know what I think about older artwork, and so art is very much still a part of my process.
Yeah. Well, I thank you. Anybody who reads this book is going to feel the way I do. It's a gem. I almost want to go back and reread it. It is that beautiful. And the way you use words is like the artist using paint and color. Because you take an ordinary line, and I'm sure you went back and rewrote.
Oh, yeah. Many times over.
Yeah.
A great deal of attention to the lines.
I thank you. Will you autograph my book?
Thank you.
And if you'd like to know what else we've been reading, visit me on the web at www.conniemartinson.com. You can read our columns from the Beverly Hills Courier. You can also see some of the older shows. Or you can link in, I guess it's called, from my website to YouTube, where there's something called, I mean, it sounds very preposterous and pretentious, Connie Martinson's channel. Well, there are about 80 shows there. Meanwhile, support your local library, go in, take out a card, that's how they get funding, or visit them even on the web so that you can get information that way. But whatever you can do, support them, donate to them, give them some of your time, and write to your city council person about the importance of keeping libraries open. What did a library mean to you in San Francisco?
It meant everything to me, and in fact, I wrote half of this book in a library.
Bravo. And we'll see you next time. Thank you.
Thank you.